1922, in jail, Gandhi wrote the startlingly truthful Experiments with Truth. Sent out a message of peace, non-violence, suffering. His struggle with him. The women were being freed. From all parts of India, they marched with Gandhi. Men and women, said Gandhi, neither can be more important than the other. Only when both are present can anything be fruitful, including politics. Neither was more important than the other. They were a peerless pair. But they must supplement each other. At the Congress meetings, women naturally understood the way of nonviolence. And it was women who served the once segregated untouchables at Congress meetings. At the Madras Congress, the signs were clearer. India, with Gandhi, was moving toward trying the technique of nonviolence. Gandhi came, his hands pressed together in the traditional pressed palms of Hindu greeting. Mrs. Naidu with the other leaders. And it was at Madras that talk went on of the use of nonviolence. It was essential now, but still difficult. But after previous experiments, they all knew it took the greatest self-discipline, a willingness to give life itself. There was a force in men's hearts waiting to be used. By the 1928 Calcutta Congress, there had been some success, some failure, with the use of the technique. But Motilal Nehru reminded them again of their growing responsibility. Dominion status was being worked toward. By 1929 at Lahore, December 31st at midnight, the leaders stood together. Dominion status had not been granted. Now they would work only for complete independence. And now Gandhi was ready for one of the great climactic experiments of his life in the power of the human spirit, the Dandi Salt March. It was in 1930. Gandhi told the people he had sent a letter to Lord Irwin, the British Viceroy, in which he spoke of his opposition to British rule, which, he said, has reduced us politically to serfdom, had even taken from the Indian the right to make his own salt from his own sea, but had taxed that salt when he had to buy it. Let there be a conference to right many wrongs, or he would start a nonviolence campaign. And he himself as a symbol would march to the sea at Dandi and himself break the salt laws by making salt. The Viceroy answered through a secretary, no conference. Powerful in the sword. Would that happen now? The marchers walked 12 miles a day on the dust roads of the countryside, every village decorated to receive them. From all over India they began coming. Their battle cry was the ancient Sanskrit, Satya Jayati, truth alone conquers. With not a single weapon but musical instruments to march to, they marched. They streamed out from the villages to meet. People knelt in the road as Gandhi passed. Women came out and placed on his forehead the mark of the third eye, the eye of wisdom. Each night they stayed at the houses in the villages, garlanded to receive them. Gandhi leading, gay, happy. Here in this peaceful march, the thousands moving in a non-violent protest, his hypothesis was being proved. Man, given an idea he could believe in, would yet make love more powerful than hate. In every village, people came to see him, and Gandhi sat and talked with all who came, for his love for these people was a painless love for them, his belief that there was a divine power in each of them. In different villages, he walked out with his followers, and sitting under the trees, he spoke to the multitudes who assembled. You will be free, he told them. This march has power, for it is truth in action. If it is truth, there is one test. Truth finally always conquers untruth. Fear nothing but to fail that truth. Injustice is an untruth. The British had said they alone could make salt, that they could tax salt without giving the right to vote on that. We must reject that injustice,
said Gandhi.
But only if we can love the British man and reject this act as a disease of a man whose health we believe in. The Congress leaders joined with him. Mrs. Naidu came to march beside Gandhi. Again and again he stopped at village after village. Again and again he spoke. This was a great act of nonviolence they were taking part in, he assured them. The world watched their actions. Let them observe their discipline carefully. They had taken the right means, the ends would be right. They were disobeying the salt laws only after they had first given them every chance. They had tried for arbitration, mediation. That was India's way. They had earned the right now to call the act evil and to make this nonviolent protest, this march to the sea. But he warned them. They were coming closer to the sea now. Let them beware against fighting evil with hate. Not lift one finger against the British or the whole purpose of the march. The great demonstration of their truth power would be lost. The power would go out of them. So Gandhi spoke. And on they came. Women and men, children and old people. It was the spirit of the American Revolution, of the French, of the British themselves, of the Boston Tea Party. The original group of 79 had now been joined by thousands. The thousands became tens of thousands. And on they marched while the world watched. This army only with banners. Marching exultantly, marching steadily, an army armed with hope and trust, marching steadily, gaily to the sound of music, until on April 5th, they reached the sea. And then Gandhi marched into the sea, and from it he took salt water to be refined into salt, breaking the law that said only the British could make salt. All along the shores of the sea, others moved in, and each one took up a container and took out the salt water. Thousands upon thousands all along the shore taking part in the act. Women marched in the streets carrying seawater. At the seashore, it was distilled, water evaporated, salt freed, and piled up. Soldiers came to confiscate the salt. Still more salt was distilled. Mrs. Naidu and Manilal Gandhi, Gandhi's son, led a march on the British salt pans behind a barbed wire enclosure. Even camera shots had to be taken hurriedly. The soldiers beat them down. But no follower of Gandhi lifted a hand against the soldiers. And still they came. Love your enemies. Bless them that curse you. Do good to them that hurt you. Manilal Gandhi and Mrs. Naidu were arrested. And here in this hut, May, at 12:45 at night, Gandhi was arrested.
It was against the uprising. The Lathi was a bamboo stick. Crowds protesting in the streets were beaten back. But still the rule of nonviolence held. No hand was raised against the soldiers. Went on. Jawaharlal Nehru was arrested. On the man. The Indian protest remained nonviolent. Motilal Nehru was arrested. Strain began to show. The British had little temperament for hitting a man who did not hit back. Gandhi had trusted to the good in them, their power for good, and passive resistance went on.